Hello, I'm Shelley Quinn, and we welcome you to 3ABN today. We're so glad that you are sharing a portion of your day with us, and we believe you're going to be blessed by the testimony you hear this hour. We want to thank you so much for your prayers and your love and your financial support of 3ABN, because you are helping us to take the gospel to evangelize the entire world. So thank you so much. Our guest today has a fascinating story, and when you listen to the early part of his life, the scripture that came to my mind was Matthew 6:33. Jesus is speaking to those who are worrying, and he's like, "Why are you worrying?" He says, "Don't worry about what you're going to eat, what you're going to drink, what you're going to wear." But then he says in Matthew 6:33, "But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you." Someone today needs to hear that. Christ tells us, don't worry about tomorrow. Sufficient for each day is the problems that you're facing. But when you look to God as Jehovah Jireh, your provider, all of your worries can be cast out. Well, let me introduce you to our very special guest, and his name is Pastor Octavian Poenaru. And Pastor Octavian is what I will call you.
Yes.
You are the pastor for the Colville District in Washington.
Yes.
Tell us where Colville is.
Well, if you'd be able to find Spokane,
okay,
probably about an hour and a half away, going north, close to Canadian border.
In the beautiful area,
yes,
then.
Yes.
Very pretty. And how many churches do you pastor?
Two. One it's Colville, the other one it's Ione.
Okay. We're very glad that you are here.
And thank you.
Can't wait to hear your testimony.
Thank you.
But first, we know you like music, and we know everyone at home always enjoys our music. And today we have someone that I actually don't know a whole lot about, this particular singer. I've not met him personally, but I always enjoy him so much. His name is Paul Kreisel, and he is going to be singing "Be Still and Know."
God, be still. speechless. Be still and know that He is God. Be still and know He is our Father. Come rest your head upon His breast. Listen to the rhythm of His unfailing heart of love, beating for His little ones, calling each of us to come. Be still.
That was Paul Kreisel, and I hope those words minister to your heart. You know, actually, the Lord tells us, or He's speaking, in Psalm 46 in verse 10, He says, be still and know that I am God. You can put your worries to rest. Just come lay your head upon my breast, and that is precious. Well, if you're just joining us a little late today, our special guest is Pastor Octavian Poenaru. He is the pastor at the Colville District in Washington.
Yes.
And we're, once again, we just want to thank you for making the trip here to 3ABN.
Thank you for inviting me.
To share this testimony. Usually I'll start off and ask somebody, when did God become real for you? But this is all about your testimony. I mean, that's what the purpose is. Let me ask you, why do you think it's important to share our personal testimonies?
Well, let me start with a story. I remember I was in the fourth year at the seminary, and along with two of my colleagues, we were going home. And this was probably in 1987, and traveling home by train. With us in the same compartment was a lady. She was a middle-aged lady, and it happened that she was a philosophy teacher. And we, the three of us, begin to talk to her about God.
Yes.
And you get into these very philosophical and controversial topics and discussions, and we wrestle with her. She was on one side proving that there is no God. Obviously, she was an atheist. And on the other side were three of us trying to bring every possible argument from logic, philosophy, history, archaeology, everything to prove that actually there is a God. Finally, the lady said, well, by the way, what did this God do for you? Mm. What did He do for you? The bottom line, and in the end, I believe that the strongest theological argument doesn't come from years of studying or from books. It comes from personal experience.
Amen.
Not that the personal experience, not that the study of the Bible is not important. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is that our personal experience with God, it's very important for us, for ourselves. And it's also the ultimate argument we can bring to someone else.
Well said, brother. And that's something that they can argue and try to refute anything you say,
exactly.
But they can't refute your personal testimony.
Yeah.
Now, you grew up in communist Romania.
Right.
Tell us a little about the family into which you were born and what their situation was.
There are some pictures with myself when I was little. I was probably 5 years old, and as you can see in the background, we grew up in someone may call it poverty. I remember sharing this experience in one church, and someone said, well, those were primitive conditions. I may agree with that. We had a well, an outhouse, and a very, very small, tiny house in the middle of a field. And my parents were very busy. My mother was a nurse, my father was a lab technician, both of them coming from the countryside and trying to build a life around the city. Working, I remember my mother working sometimes two shifts, and again, very busy with life.
Trying to survive.
Trying to survive, and that didn't leave too much time for family, religion, as you may call it. And during my childhood, I do not remember having worship, family worship.
But your parents were Christians.
My parents were Christians, yes. My parents, at least, we went to the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Okay.
And I think they had faith in God, and they had some experiences of God. But one thing I believe it was missing, and that was the time, the personal time of God, the personal devotion for themselves and for us as a family.
Right.
And that impacted all of us, I believe. Many, many years after that, I was talking to my father, and he acknowledged the fact, saying, "Son, I have to tell you that the first part of our lives, we were not very close to God. We would go to church and we would do the best we could, but this very important piece, which is the devotional life, was actually missing."
Yes.
And he acknowledged that. The effect was that as a child, I do not remember God as being present in my life almost at all. And you don't see that. I mean, outside, I was like most of the other kids, but deep inside of me, I don't think I had God.
Okay, and you know, I just want to kind of underscore what you're saying here, because what I'm hearing, at least, is you had parents who were believers. They took
yes.
you to church.
Yes.
But church wasn't enough. You needed that to be modeled in your home. You needed to learn to have a personal relationship with the Lord, and that was missing. So you're growing up kind of in a cultural way, or there's some of God in your life. You know He's there, but there's no closeness. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Okay. Again, I think the life of some people, if not of many people, gravitates around our earthly existence, work,
sure,
coming home, doing this and doing that, and busy with life, and the 24 hours are actually very short for a lot of people. They have to wake up early in the morning, go to work, come back late evenings, and obviously you postponed the things which are not the most important, at least apparently, and probably in a lot of homes, what happens, we leave for the last it's the communion with God. I remember sometime in the evening, my parents wanted to do the study, to read some of the Bible, and basically falling asleep while you keep the Bible open.
Yeah. And there's a lot of people today who come home and they'll say they come home from work and they're so tired.
Yes.
They don't have the mental energy. They'll sit in
right.
front of the television, and it's okay to watch 3ABN, but I mean, if you're just watching regular secular programming,
yeah.
many times people are influenced by that because and children are influenced by that because
yeah.
parents are too tired to do anything
Absolutely.
Else.
Absolutely. My parents actually bought a TV. I was probably 6 or 7 years old, and I remember we didn't like the Russian movies because they're very boring, but we loved the American movies. They're cowboys and Indians, and the kids are mimicking what they see, and they try to reproduce in their own life at their level what they actually see. There is the well-known statement, by beholding,
you become.
We are changed.
Yeah.
And probably it was in one of those days when I watched in the evening a movie with cowboys and Indians, and I remember the next day, my mother was a nurse, and she had at home a syringe and the needles, and I got a few needles and a few sticks, and I put the needles in at the top of the sticks, and I made my arrows, and I got outside, and
oh, no.
I was the Indian, and I saw some of the pigs of my neighbor, and I started chasing them and hunting them, and actually I shot at one of them, and the pig with the arrow starts running back home, and I realized that I was in trouble.
Oh.
Fortunately, the arrow fell down. But the point is that media actually controlled my life at that time. Okay. And I think those were the days when 40, 50 years ago, when the movies were not as what they are today. And
they were a lot milder back then.
Oh, yeah, in black and white.
Yeah.
Then, and the communists, they basically had a pretty strong screening on what they allowed to be on the media. But I remember I knew everything. I knew every movie that was supposed to be during the week. And basically, the worship family was when we watched a movie. That was when the family came together.
That became your family altar.
Exactly. That was the time when we as a family came together.
Okay.
And that that had a very strong impact on my life, because very shortly, or in a very short time, God was out of the picture, at least for me.
Okay. Now let me ask you a question, because you grew up in an Adventist home in a communist country. Did you, I know that most of the communist countries, they do go to school on Saturdays.
Yeah.
Did you attend school on Saturday, or did you observe the Sabbath?
If you can't believe in this 50% obedience, half of the time I was in church, half of the time I was in school. The morning I was in school, in the afternoon we went to church, because there were programs in at the church in the afternoon. The truth is that, as I say sometime, for me at that time, the best moments of the Sabbath were when the Sabbath was over. Because the Sabbath or the Saturday was very, in my mind, was very restrictive, and I didn't have any pleasure in, I was not interested in spiritual things at all. And I was looking forward for the Sabbath to be over and watch the Saturday night movie.
Were you an excellent student? What kind of student were you as a young
boy? No. Actually, the first grades, 1 to 4, I was the bottom line student in my class, and I'm not exaggerating at all. I was the last student in my class, and things were not going well at all.
So you just weren't interested in studies, or?
You know, I don't remember exactly why. But I know that I had big problems in school, not only learning-wise in terms of the academics, but behavior-wise. Okay. Lying, stealing, it was okay for me.
Mm.
Well, if there is no God in your life, why not?
Okay.
And I was, I remember on a Sabbath day in the morning, I went once to school and I stolen a toy, which was a pistol, from one of my colleagues. I don't know how I was so brilliant in devising the plans to steal things from this colleague of mine, with all the colleagues present and not being caught, but I was failing on every other subject.
Mm.
And anyway, I was caught in the afternoon by a Grammy. It's interesting how God works.
Yes, grandmothers know.
Grandmother, yes. She. I mean, I tricked everybody. I lied to everybody. And in the afternoon, I was called by an old, wonderful grandmother. That's what I remember. And I failed in. My father wanted me to play violin, and he sent me to the music school, and I began to play violin. But I was failing again. I was not interested in music theory or playing the instrument. And in the sixth grade, I had to basically abandon the music school because I failed the exams at the end of the year, both of them.
So how did God finally get your attention?
I think some of us, and I'm going to say it, probably it's very strong the way I'm going to say it, but some of us get tired of our own stupidity. And you see yourself failing, or I believe that God helps us see, I don't know how that happens. But I think that God is very, very patient with us and is trying in many, many ways to talk to us. I was beginning to see my own failing at all levels.
What age were you then?
I was 14.
It had to be God who was helping you if you're
seeing
that. Yes,
I was 14 and I, and at that age, your friends are a very powerful influence and they change. I mean, you listen to your friends much more than you listen to your parents or teachers or anybody else. And I had a very good friend of mine who was leading me into all kinds of bad stuff. And I was joining this gang of guys and doing all kinds of things. And
so your friends were more from the school and not from the church, is that what?
School is life. I mean, okay. Church was once a week, and going to church was just because I had to, and I didn't have much interest in church. But this friend of mine, the best friend of mine at one point, along with other guys, they mocked me to a point, and I'm not going to be too graphic, but I remember being in the classroom when they, after they, because it was customary. Today they mock me, tomorrow we mock you, and make fun of the other ones as part of life. In the gang, and not a gang in the real terms of doing all kinds of
not
violent actions,
crime, but
yeah.
Okay.
And this friend of mine, he and the other guys, they really, really mocked me. And I remember I was left in the classroom, and some tears came to my eyes. And I said, "Well, why am I here? Why did I end up like this?" I said, "This is what I deserve. Mm-hmm. I chose to go with them, and now this is what I get." Also, at that time, it was a new year, and in the church I grew up, every time at the new year, they will just give a small piece of paper with a promise from the Bible to all the church members, and everybody just choose one, picked one. And I was curious, it was like lottery, and I said, "Well, let's see what I get this year." And to my surprise, I got the passage from Joshua 24:15, which says, "And if seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourself this day whom you will serve."
Amen.
When I remember, again, I was not a godly person or interested in religion or God, but when I read that passage, I realized that God was talking to me. I don't know how can you make that, but to me, God was saying, "Octavian, you have playing this game for a long time. Yes. It's time for you to choose." And I think at that point, I was seriously considering to change my life.
And you were 14 years old.
I was 14 years old.
But the Word of God is alive and active, and God was speaking to you through that precious Scripture, "Choose this day whom you're going to serve." So now God's got your attention. And for a 14-year-old, usually, you know, I think typically you think of 14 is the time that children actually are, especially boys, it seems, as testosterone kicks in, everything, that they're going a little more off the path at that age. You're usually trying to rein them in. But I know that the Holy Spirit was working with you. So now God's got your attention. What happened?
Well, you mentioned at the beginning another Bible passage, which was Matthew 6, verse 33, "Seek first the kingdom of God." I remember beginning to read. I truly believe it's fundamentally important for the spiritual life to spend time with God in studying the Bible, in reading the Bible and other spiritual books. Probably, it's difficult at the beginning to understand the Bible, and even now for me, you may call it a professional, but there are portions of the Bible which are not easy to understand. I would say, don't worry, read it anyway, because I don't have to understand everything or all the Bible. God will speak to you or to me in the place where I am.
Amen.
And reading that passage, and I was beginning at that time to read the book, The Great Controversy.
Did someone encourage you to read?
Yes.
Okay.
Actually, I have to say, none of us is where we are without the help of God and other people.
Okay.
a few things happened in my life right at that moment. I remember a man came in our church at that point, and I owe him a lot of my, in a sense, a lot of change. He's just a human being like everybody else, but his name is, I'm going to say his name. Some of the listeners may recognize his name if they are from that country. Vasile was his name. Well, he impressed me by his modesty and by his amazing intelligence. He knew the whole book of Revelation by heart, the whole book of Isaiah by heart, a lot of Psalms, James, Saint Peter, First Peter, a lot of portions of the Bible by heart. He has a vast knowledge of history and music, and I was impressed. Mm-hmm. And
I'm impressed too.
At that time, he organized the youth in my church. We had a small orchestra. Finally, he actually brought us together, and we had a small orchestra, a classic type of orchestra, first violin, second violin, viola, and cello. And we begin to play classical music and hymns, and it was a great time in church. In the same time, we begin to study as a church. Both parents and children will study for a week the great controversy at home, and Sabbath afternoon we'll meet, Saturday afternoon we'll meet and discuss the chapter. Very interactive, very interesting for me. And I was hungry. I was hungry to know more about God, and I was very much impressed by what I was finding in this book, The Great Controversy, how some people loved God, like the first Christians. They loved God to the extent that they were willing to give up their lives.
Yes.
And I said to myself, well, am I supposed to be in the same heaven with those who gave their lives for Christ while my life is like this? Mm. And I begin to change. Actually, I was baptized very soon. Usually people got to through a baptism class, but I remember they had the wisdom and the graciousness to accept me for the baptism without even going through a baptism class.
Okay.
And I was baptized.
This is you on the end with the in the robe.
Right.
With
tall and skinny as today.
Yeah.
And I remember I forgot home my baptism clothing. But I was baptized, and it was a visible change in my life, in all aspects. My parents saw that I was becoming very different.
Did this impact their relationship with the Lord as they saw you changing?
I'm not sure that happened right then and there.
Okay.
And I was so much preoccupied by my own life. I didn't know exactly what was happening with them. We went to church, and there were some good times when I remember my parents trying to, by that time, I have a sister, and they were trying to pull the family together and study more. We got out of from the level. They built the second house. It was more comfortable. In a sense, they had more time. And I think they begin to change, but I do not remember significant changes.
Now, Octavian, when you really became serious about God, I know that I've talked with others who grew up in communist Romania, other Adventist Christians who chose to honor God's Sabbath and did not attend school on Saturday, even though it was mandatory, and they were punished and persecuted for it. What was your, did you finally get to that point that you said, okay, I'm not going to school on Saturday, or did you continue to go?
It's very interesting because we didn't talk about this, but you bring this up, and that's exactly what happened. And I, for most of my life, I went to school on Saturday. And at the point where I began to change, I was skipping classes in school as much as I could. But at one point when I was in the junior year in the high school, I decided to not to go to school by my own. And I remember we had some family discussions. My parents told me, they said, Octavian, you go to school, you finish your school. And I was studying electronics. I wanted to become an engineer in electronics, but this was a high school that prepared you for that with the profile where you study mathematics and physics and other disciplines related to the field. And they were afraid that I'm not going to finish the school, which could have happened very, very easily because we had some classes Saturdays only. Mm-hmm. And if you miss those classes, then you basically fail. Mm-hmm. It's interesting how God, there are many, many stories. I believe when God worked in a very interesting way, for example, one of them, I had a teacher, he was a very busy man. He was the director of a huge electrical plant, and very busy man, but he was teaching one class in the electronic domain. Well, this man missed the whole quarter. And there was the last week. I mean, in communism, it was possible. He was an extremely busy man. He missed the whole quarter. And finally, there was 1 week left. And he said, everybody be ready. I remember, I think it was on Wednesday. We had classes with him Wednesday and Saturday. I said, everybody be ready. I'm coming Wednesday, give you a test. And Saturday, give you another test. You have two grades, accumulate both of them and give you an average grade and you finish the quarter. I was praying that he would come on Wednesday. He didn't come. The only day left was Saturday. Mm. It was very difficult, very, very, very difficult for me to make a decision. Should I go? Should I not? Should I go? Should I not? Finally, I decided not to go. I was fasting probably that Sabbath and praying for a miracle.
Are you 18 or you were 17?
I was 17.
17 at this point.
And finally, in the evening after sundown, I went in town. I knew that I would find in town some of my colleagues. And I met one of them, said, Octavian, the teacher told to give him a call, said, give him a call tonight because he wants to give you a test on Tuesday. And I was so happy. Tuesday, the school was over, the last day of school. And I was so happy. I said, praise God. He'll give me a chance to take an exam or by myself. I called the teacher that Saturday night, told him who I was, and I remember telling him, I said, I missed the school not because I'm negligent or ignoring you. It is because my moral convictions. And he said, don't worry, I gave you a grade anyway. And he gave me a grade anyway. Now, you judge this kind of events or things, but that's what happened.
So God was blessing your commitment. And then as you graduated from high school, you didn't go to college right away. Tell us what happened.
Well, for most, 99% of the young people, the next step in life was the military. We were drafted in the military.
Okay, so that's kind of like an automatic service.
Yeah. And for the Seventh-day Adventists, that was a big, big question. As far as I know, United States, it's very, in United States, you have, basically you are not drafted, you don't have to go to the military. But if you end up in the military, it's still a tough place to be.
Yes.
And it was very difficult. I had to make a decision. You don't make the decisions at the time when you face the challenge. Usually you make your mind before that.
Yes.
And
what you're referring to here is the difficulty of working on Sabbath, of breaking your promise to the Lord to keep the Sabbath when you're in the military, right?
I mean, my question is, are the Ten Commandments always valid anywhere and
yes.
at any time?
Yes.
If we say no, that means that there are exceptions. Now, who judges when to make the exceptions?
Right.
If there are the Word of God, and if they are absolutes, then probably they are valid any time and anywhere. Yeah, I ended up in the service in the military, and because of my background in electronics, I was a radar operator in an anti-aircraft unit. And it was very difficult for me. But God prepared me ahead of time because with the challenges in the school, and then I had to work for a few months, the challenges at the workplace, all of this, they were preparing me.
And those challenges being that they were asking you to...
The Sabbath issue.
The Sabbath was the challenge. That
yeah,
people
the Sabbath.
Wanted to
work. And the environment, working with different people, of many of them of a very ungodly behavior and language and making jokes on you as a Christian and of your beliefs. And
so what did happen in the service when they're demanding that or commanding that you work on Sabbath? How did you handle that?
It was not only working on Sabbath, but it was actually the military training, because every Saturday you had to go for trainings. At the beginning, I didn't know what to do. I didn't work. I refused to work, which was difficult enough and hard enough. And an interesting thing happened. Our captain was an older gentleman who, he was a staunch communist. And the fact that he was old and just with the grade of captain, at least in that environment, he was not promoted. He was a very stubborn guy. And soon enough, after I was enrolled in that particular unit, he was moved to another unit. And I remember meeting him almost close to the end of the service or somewhere there, and he told me, Octavian, if they didn't move me, I would have moved you. Meaning that he would have probably sent me to the court-martial. But God moved him.
Amen.
And it was, the point is, in the beginning, I went for some military training, and at one point I decided not to go. And from that time on, I did not go to work or to the military training. And with a lot of confrontations and meeting people and talking to people, I remember one Saturday morning, I was basically taken to a place where I didn't know where, but a political officer came and he said, you need to come with me. And my immediate superior told me, Octavian, I had with him many, many debates on religions and discussing a lot of him. And he came to me and said, Octavian, you go there, you go to these big guys, say what they say whatever they say, don't get yourself in trouble and don't get us in trouble. And I said, yes, sir, I'll see about that. And I left, and I remember waiting for 2 hours in this big building where the top colonels and the top officers were, and finally we were invited in this big room, big table with maybe 10 or 11 other high officers, and the general, or the man who replaced him, was sitting at a table, and he asked me, why is it, what's up with you? He had the file, and he opened the file, and he began to read. And he said, why did they disfellowship you from the youth communist organization? Basically, every youth was automatically a member of the youth communist organization. I was one, meaning nothing, but everybody was one. But at one point, because of the Sabbath, they threw me out, which I didn't mind. It didn't mean anything anyway. And he said, why did that happen? And probably he had a report that I was this fellowship. And I said, because of my beliefs. And the general looked at me and said, what do you believe? And I think this is a very crucial question. What do you believe?
Amen.
And I was 19, being in front of all this top people, your freedom was in their hands. And when he said, what do you believe? I remember what I've said. You don't have time to prepare your sermons or answer. You don't study for that ahead of time. I said, I believe that there is one God, the creator of heaven and earth, and he will come to judge every one of us. That's what I believed. And once I've said it, I kind of especially the second part, that he will
it's
come
like,
to judge.
Where did this come from, huh?
Yes, because
the Holy Spirit was directing.
You don't schedule that kind of answer. Yes. And I remember the journal stood up. It was a beautiful day in May, sunny outside, and he had big windows. And he stood up and he came to me and he said, "Young man, you should know there is no God." And I said, "Dismissed." And I left. After such a meeting, the only logical following step was to be court-martialed, because public statements like that one in front of high officials could not have another end. And I was expecting that. Well, that didn't happen. Why? How? I don't know.
God's hand was over you.
Yeah, and I remember that when I was close to finish the service, I had left a few days. They were left a few days. And I randomly came into the big dormitory where we had for soldiers and looking for something. And when I was supposed to get out, the captain, my captain, came in, with whom I had many discussions also about God, religion, and this and that. And he said, "Hey, Octavian, come here." "Yes, sir." And he said, "Listen, I have a question for you." He said, "In all this time, did you have anybody in a very, very high position that protected you?" It was just me and him. And I looked at him and I said, "Yes, sir. I have someone in a very, 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 very high position, and he protected me all this time."
Oh.
And he understood that I was speaking about God.
Yes.
But the funny part is that finished the service, went back home, got to work. And another wonderful thing, I was accepted at the seminary to study, to be a pastor.
So electronics, as far as you were concerned, being an engineer, God had you beyond that.
I didn't want to be a pastor. I didn't plan to be a pastor. I was not interested in becoming a pastor, actually. The most interesting thing for me was actually to talk to people about God. That's because I think, or to lead them to believe in God. That's the most wonderful thing. Anyway, I ended up at the seminary, finished the seminary, and moved in my third district, away from my home, about three, four hours away from my home. And one day I was talking to one of my head deacons, and I said, "I need to buy some gas containers. Do you know anybody that sells any of this?" He says, "Oh, my neighbor is cleaning his garage." "Oh," said I, "can I buy them?" I said, "Sure, come to me Tuesday morning." And I went to him while I was waiting for the neighbor to come. The wife of the head deacon said, "Pastor Octavian, my neighbor is from your area," from where I was, and I did my military service in my hometown. He says, "Oh, it's from my area, interesting." And he said, "Oh, and by the way, he was a high military official." I said, "High? Do you know his name?" And she says, "Sure." The man was the general.
So how many years was this?
About 15 years after.
15 years later, the general who said to you, "There is no God."
Yes. And here the doors open and the man comes, and here is the general coming. And I looked at him and he looked at me, and he came and he had a very interesting reaction. He came and he embraced me, hugged me, and said, "Hey, how are you doing, soldier?"
So you're still living in Romania at this point?
Yes.
Okay.
And he hugged me and said, "Hey, how are you doing?" I said, "Well, I'm doing fine. I'm here in this area now." And we begin to talk, and I bought the container for him. But then I asked him and I said, "How are you doing, General?" He says, "Well, I'm not doing that well. My wife is getting blind, and I've been retired for some years." Now, this is after revolution, about maybe 10 years after revolution. Or anyway, "I'm here by myself. I'm very lonely. I have two sons. None of them are talking to me anymore. and I have nobody. And he said, Once upon a time I was somebody. With a phone call, I could have everything I want. Now I'm nobody. I get out on the street, nobody even says hello to me. I'm so lonely. And I said, General, by the way, do you believe in God? And he said, sure I do. Of course I do. Of course I do believe in God. I said, interesting. Do you have a Bible? Oh, sure I have a Bible, and I read it every day. I said, oh, that's wonderful, I said. And I was debating in my mind to, I was thinking to remind him of what happened, but I was impressed not to do it. And I didn't say anything. I remember later on I visited him with my wife. We took some cookies and I took, a great controversy for him. And basically that was it.
So you don't know if 15 years before, if he actually was just putting on saying he didn't believe in God, or if he then had come to know the Lord afterwards?
You know, I believe that the picture of life changes.
Yes.
And people change. And I don't know, only God knows the hearts of people. And he's the one to judge everybody.
Yes, yes. Now, you moved from Romania to Norway.
Right.
You worked in Norway as a pastor.
Not as a pastor.
Okay, what did you do?
I worked as a pastor in Romania for 12 years. Then we moved to Norway because I was always interested in new ways of reaching out to people.
Right.
And there was this health institution, and I wanted to know how do they reach out to people using health methods. And we worked in a health, in a lifestyle institution, and then we moved to United States when I came to study at Loma Linda, came to study health.
Okay, so you got your master's in public health there, and now you're back pastoring again.
Yes, I'm back pastoring.
Just tell us, we've just got a few minutes left. Tell us a little bit about your family now. God has brought you full circle. You're married, and how many children do you have?
We have one son. His name is Nathan. He finished at Walla Walla with a health science major. He was accepted at Loma Linda School of Dentistry, but now he took a year off to go to do mission work, and he's in Argentina at La Plata University, working with them to develop a health outreach program. He'll be back in the summer to go back to school.
Okay.
And Alina, my wife, she's RN, and works as a nurse and helps me with ministry as much as we can. She loves cooking. She wrote a cookbook, a vegan cookbook.
Okay, good. So, and I'm assuming that what your parents did not do, you made certain that with your family that you had the daily devotionals, the worship time, so that obviously your son is giving his heart to the Lord if he has graduated and he's doing missionary work. So was that something that was terribly important to you, is to make sure that you did for your family what was not done in yours?
I think in the end and fundamentally, being genuine, it's very important.
Yes, amen.
You can't make someone religious. And we sometimes fake religion.
Yes.
It's not gonna work. Then as parents, if we talk in these terms, we have to be truly, truly genuine.
Amen.
And our kids will see that. They know that.
Yes, amen. So it's very important to be authentic. One quick question that I'm going to reserve first. I want to let you know, if you would like to get in touch with Pastor Octavian, you can. We've got an address roll for you that will let you contact him. Maybe you'd like to have him come speak even at your church. Here's how you may get in touch with him.
If you would like to invite Octavian to your church to speak, or if you'd like to contact him, you can write to Octavian Poenaru, 1022 North Elm Street, Colville, Washington, 99114. That's Octavian Poenaru, 1022 North Elm Street, Colville, Washington, 99114. You can call 509-675-5728. That's 509-675-5728. Or email him at octavianpoenaru@gmail.com. That's octavianpoenaru@gmail.com. Call or write to him today.
That's how you may get in touch with Pastor Octavian Poenaru. We only have a couple of minutes left, but I have to hear about your parents. When your parents saw what God did in your life and how seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness changed your life, what kind of effect did it have on theirs, or how did God work in their life?
I think we all grow in our relationship with God, and I have to say that we have to be kind to each other and tolerant to each other, because we have our own. God actually is the one who knows what happens in someone's life and where do they come from. To answer your questions, I think my parents have changed. I actually have a very good relationship with my parents. They are still alive. And my father, in a special way, he has become a very godly man. He takes more time. The fact that he studies more, has more time to commune with God in his own personal life, that changed him. Yeah. And he confessed that to me. He actually said, Octavian, my life has changed by the fact that I spend more time with God in my devotional time.
Praise the Lord. You know, God has, I know he must have had his hand on you from the very beginning, because you have you're compassionate, but God has given you uncommon wisdom in recognizing human frailties and dealing with them in the way that he does. So we're going to come back in just a second to have a closing thought from Pastor Octavian. But right now we want to go to the news break and let you know what's going on at 3ABN. Well, today we've been talking with Pastor Octavian Poenaru, and he's been sharing his testimony. And during the news break, I was just telling him, and I'll just repeat it on air, God has given you a special gift to, I believe, to read people's hearts and to be sensitive to that. How important is, you used two words during the news break, authenticity and commitment. Talk about that just a moment.
Well, in the end, what matters the most, both for ourselves and for our people, for other people, is the truthfulness and authenticity. Even as hard as it is, but I think we have to face the question: Am I truly in love with God? Am I truthful to God deep in my heart? That doesn't mean that we don't struggle with this or that, and where we are not. We can be tempted and we can struggle, but in the end, the question is how truthful, how committed am I in my heart? Mm-hmm. And the authenticity and commitment, I think they go hand to hand. I think commitment, it's a very, very important thing. If we are not committed, in the end, somewhere, a crisis will come and the collapse will follow. Mm-hmm. But if we are committed, God will take us through in His grace and in His power.
And I think that the more, as the Bible says, if we understand how much He loves us, we'll love Him because He first loved us. And that's so important, is to understand that the heart of your Father, how much He is looking to you to be authentic, not to hide, be authentic, but to commit yourself to Him. Pastor Octavian, thank you so much.
Thank you for having
being
me.
Here today. And we've enjoyed your testimony. And may God richly bless the work that you're doing there in Washington. And for those of you at home, our prayer for you is that the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit will be with you today and always. Bye-bye.